Great to see everybody here. If you would come in, find a place, and please stand as we start with our opening song.
Come with that love the Lord and let your joy be known. Join in a song with sweet accord. Join in a song with sweet accord. And thus around the throne, and thus around the throne, we're marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The hills of Zion yield 1,000 sacred seeds. Before we reach the heavenly field, before we reach the heavenly field, for on the golden streets, upon the golden streets, we're marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. And let our songs abound and every tear be dry. We're marching through Emmanuel's crown. We're marching through Emmanuel's crown. To
good to have everybody here today. Thankful for your presence. Welcome. Well, let's just be sure and say this is not the Big Top as it has been all week long, but welcome to the Big Top. We're really glad to have you here today. We have had a very successful week of VBS this week, and we had a whole lot of community people here for us. I just want to challenge you, church. Our children can invite their friends at the rate of approximately 5 to 1. So for every member we had here, we had 5 visitors here. You should go, wow. We are impressed with our kids. I just am kind of curious what we would need to do for our adults, for you to invite 5 of your friends. And not just invite them, but to actually make sure that they get there. So we're really thankful for a great week of VBS where we learned an awful lot about Jesus, and we learned in the way in which he wasn't just the greatest of showmen, but in reality, he was the person who wanted to show us, show me his greatness, and that God wanted us to know how wonderful he were. We want to thank so many for their help with VBS. Many of you here tonight, today, this morning, were involved in VBS, whether you were teaching or leading groups or helping out with snacks, whatever it may be. I want to say a special thank you. We had an overwhelming group come and help us. You have no idea how different this building looks from what it did just Saturday night at 8 o'clock. So barely 12 hours ago, it has been transformed and cleaned up, and folks putting chairs back in here exactly where they are now for you. By the way, do you feel very comfortable? Because we had a plan to rearrange the auditorium a little bit, and so, but we have a wedding next weekend, so we left it exactly the way it is. So you got to sit in your traditional seat. Aren't you thankful? But nonetheless, we had a great week, and those folks that helped us out. But particularly, I would ask all of you to join me in thanking Haley and Chelsea Yates right over here, and John there right. Could y'all please stand? Please stand. Please stand. John, join them. Their right hand guy. Folks, these guys work very hard. So thanks for your help. Chelsea and Haley, just a great job, and again, one of the things that I get to do at VBS is I get to stand up here and see children's faces and to see the smiles as they come, as they head off to all their activities, but then particularly to watch them running back in here with just so excited about what has gone on for about the last hour and a half, and nobody bored, and just excited about it. And those things don't happen by accident. So we're really thankful, and thank you for being here to be a part of it. We're not quite done with VBS before the service is over. We got one more thing. We want to bring a little bit of VBS to you here before we go. If you're a guest with us today, we're thankful that you've come, and particularly if you're one of those families who visited it during VBS, we're glad that you chose to be with us this morning. We would ask that you'd fill out one of the blue guest cards that you'll find in the pocket on the back of the chair right in front of you there, and to place that filled out card, filling out as much of the information on both sides of the card as you're comfortable with, place that in the collection tray as it comes by in the middle of our service. We hope that you got a copy of the Caring and Sharing on your way in, a number of things happening there that you'll want to be sure and take a look at as the week unfolds, as we recover from VBS, and as we head into the 4th of July. We've got some things going on for us still, including gathering tonight at 6 o'clock, and would love to have you be a part of that. We're really thankful to have folks into town, possibly coming for, again, a little bit of a holiday time, and we're glad that you're here. Whatever brings you to our services today, we're glad that you've come. We hope that you've been blessed. It's our hope that this service is part of that blessing, and so we're really, really glad that you're here. We're going to take just a moment as we open up to greet one another in the Lord, and please look around and find an unfamiliar face and introduce yourself and welcome people. We got some folks that are with us, and we'll do that in just a bit. But we want to greet one another in the Lord, so let's stand and do that very quickly.
Oh, to be like the blessed Redeemer, this is my constant longing and prayer. Gladly I'll forget all those treasures, Jesus, thy perfect likeness to wear. Oh, to be like thee, oh, to be like thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as thou art. Come in thy sweetness, come in thy fullness, send thine own image deep on my heart.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
There's a story told of a man in chain being led by two guards up to the judge. And as he stood in front of the judge, and the judge looked down at him for, just a little bit. And then the judge turned his head to his clerk, and he says, "Read the charges." So the clerk opened up the book and started reading the charges, one after another. And the man turned and looked at the clerk as he read the charges. And with each charge, his head came down, each slowly but surely. Finally, at finishing, the judge turned his face back towards the man, and he says, "What have you to say?" The man, very soft tone, said, "Guilty, Your Honor." "Guilty indeed," said the judge, "and the punishment is death." And the sorrow that just filled him. He turned his head down, and in just a whisper, he said, "Oh God, have mercy on me. Give me a chance, and let me live a different life." The judge heard what he said, and the judge stood up, went around his desk to the front, took the man's head and lifted it up and looked in his eyes, and he said, "Son, do you really mean what you said?" And with tears in his eyes, the man said, "Yes." He says, "All right." He said, "This is what we're going to do. I'm not only your judge, I'm also your savior. I'm going to take your charges. I'm going to take your punishment. I'm going to die for you, but I want you to live for me." Did you hear what he said? What the judge said? "I want you to live for me." That's specific. That's not a choice of the man as to what he wants to live, a different life, but the life that is different is the one that he has been given. Who's the man? That's me and you. Who's the judge? That's Christ. He's also our Savior and Redeemer. The question I want to put before you this morning is, what does a man need to do in order to live that new birth, that new life? Brethren, we have been taught in June and previous months the key to that question. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for this congregation, your church that meets here, for all its members and their service of love to bring praise, glory, and honor to you, our God. We especially thank you this morning for the visitors who have joined us in worshiping you this morning in spirit and in truth. We pray your love and blessing on all present, on those that were not able to be here this morning, and on all the churches of Christ throughout this world today. Father, we thank you for Jesus Christ, our Lord, and for the awesome month which we have enjoyed in him this June, of the teachings and the preachings on what and why we need to do to live the new birth and new life in Christ. Father, in Christ, we have been given a summary of one word, what we need to do to live that new life. And that word is focus. Focus in Christ by seeking him, seeking His Word, by following His example, by obeying His commands, by devoting ourselves totally to becoming more like Him and less like ourselves on a daily basis, and by committing to do good works He has planned for us. Focus is what helps us to overcome the distractions that cause us to wander away from where we need to be. Christ is the only source and example we have as an approved guide to the new life. Help us to remember that we need Christ dwelling and reigning in all areas of our lives, in our homes, in our neighborhoods, in our workplace, where we shop, and everywhere we go. Help us to focus on Him and be a reflection of Christ living in us. Father, this morning we also pray for souls in special needs. We pray that You would save every lost soul that calls on Jesus today, that You will heal every sick soul that calls on Jesus today, that You will comfort every bereaved soul that calls on Jesus today, that You will deliver every struggling soul who calls on Jesus today, and that You will bless them as You have blessed us. Father, forgive us of all our sins and shortcomings. Thank You, Father, for Jesus, for the indwelling Spirit, for the lessons on focusing so we may live the new life as we should. All these things we pray in the name, blessed name of Jesus. Amen.
Who breaks the power
of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King of all kings, who shakes the water with holy thunder and leads us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King of all kings.
This is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace.
This morning we're looking at God's vision for families, and one of the things families do is eat together. And so as we share this meal this morning, a symbolic meal, we're reminded that God has included us in His family and that we are members of the same family. And so we take this in order to remember Jesus, and I'd like to read a passage from Ephesians 1 that describes how Jesus has included us as part of His family. So, and starting in verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before Him. In love, He predestined us for adoption to Himself as sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of His will, to the praise of His glorious grace, with which He has blessed us in the beloved. In Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of His grace, which He lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of His will, according to His purpose, which He set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in Him, things in heaven and things on earth." Let's pray together. Lord, we thank You for Jesus. We thank You for His sacrifice on our behalf and His life that He gave that allows us to be adopted as children of Yours, to be restored to a relationship with You, that we can be viewed as clean and whole in Your sight. We thank You for Him offering Himself. We remember His body as we take this bread now. It's in His name we pray. Amen. My younger brother is adopted, and even as a child, I used to think, you know, lucky for him, right? Because he gets to be part of our family, which I thought was pretty awesome. And so I thought, you know, that was a really, say, good set of circumstances for him, because my family decided to choose him and to make him part of our family. And so When I read that about how God has adopted us as sons and daughters, it makes me think, you know, lucky for us, right? Because our choice was not so good, and yet He extends that love and includes us in His holy and perfect family. Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank You now for this juice which we take to remember Jesus' blood that He shed on our behalf, paying the very high price it takes to redeem us. As Victor mentioned, the penalty is death. And God doesn't overlook that penalty. He doesn't make it go away. He doesn't compromise His justice. Death had to be the penalty for sin. And we're so thankful that You allowed Jesus to give of Himself to die on our behalf. And in doing so, redeemed us to You. We remember that sacrifice as we take this juice now. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This time we're going to take up an offering. If you're visiting with us, please don't feel obliged to give financially. We'd ask that you return the guest card in the plate as it passes by. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank You for the many ways that You've blessed us. We thank You for the life that we live here. We thank you for the freedoms we enjoy. We thank you for our family, friends, and the many ways that our life is easier than so many around the world. Lord, one of the things we recognize is we have great material wealth. And Lord, we know that that's a difficult thing to manage, and that comes with a lot of temptation to hold on to that. And Lord, we ask that you would help us to manage those things well. Because you've given us a lot, help us to manage it well and to honor you in the way that we handle our money and our finances. Lord, we ask that you would be with us as we give part of that back to you to further the work here of the church. We ask that you would bless that money and be the way it's used, and help it to be used in a way that will spread your kingdom throughout the world. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, it's different, so listen. So we're going to have an opportunity for the kids to come up and give a gift, but don't leave yet. Stay up here, right? When you come up and give your gift, stay right up here for a moment. We'll dismiss you to praise kids in stage two here in a moment. But as you come up, stay here with me.
VBS, why don't you stay up here? We're going to teach the moms and dads one of the songs we like to VBS. And so you can stand up here with me, and we'll face the audience and sing the song. We have learned several new songs, and of course, we always get to refresh our memory of some old songs. But it seems to not do many other times of year. So many of them are very meaningful, and so we want to share those with you. This one of those. It's a song about trusting God. It's called "I Trust in You," okay? And the one emotion out of this I want you to learn is that, you know, how if you hold on to a rope, you really are dependent on that rope to hold you up. So I'm trusting you. So everybody,
I'm trusting you.
Good, here we go. Are we ready?
You know, one of the things I really enjoy and appreciate about this church is throughout our service, there's so many moments that we can take something with us, and not just here to worship, but there's throughout the whole service are great things. I really appreciated what Vic had to say and loved the way he phrased it, that the sentence was death, and in exchange for that, we live for Christ. I love that. And then also, there's not that many churches that have a minister whose wheelhouse is not only getting up here on Sunday morning, but dressing in a ringmaster's, you know, coat and tails, and can just, you know, lead our youngest in spiritual worship. So great job, Allen, all the way around. Today's scripture, we're going to jump around. We're going to be in the text from Ephesians chapter 5 and Ephesians chapter 6. And we're going to start out in verse 1. We'll skip a few verses. So if you're keeping score at home, you can look up on the overhead or follow along in your Bible. And I am to the age where I have my glasses on to see you, take my glasses off to see what's in front of me. Ephesians 5, verse 1, follow God's example. Therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. And chapter 5, verse 8, for you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for the fruit of light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. And verse 15, be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Verse 22, wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. Verse 25, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. And in chapter 6, verse 1, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. And finally, in verse 4, fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord.
If you would, please let's stand for this song.
You give life, you are love, you bring life to the darkness.
We pour our grace, it's your grace. be seated.
And the whole church said. Jaden, come on up here real quick, if you would. If you don't know Jaden Moreno, you have missed out. Jaden has been a part of our church for about the last 2 years. Am I correct in saying that? And has put Christ on in baptism, wanted to get involved in the youth group. He's been a guest at our home multiple times, and he's been a guest, and not just a guest, but a huge part of our church family, and it's been a joy. Jaden graduated this year and is headed off to sort of boot camp thing for the National Guard now, and on to a career with the National Guard, and we're excited for him, but we wanted to pray, and he leaves...
Tomorrow,
okay. It's what, and where's the destination again?
Missouri, in Fort Leonard Wood.
Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. Okay, very good. We wanted to pray over him before he headed that way, so I'd ask that you would join. And these guys are family. Would y'all mind coming up and surrounding him? Wherever you are, if you are willing to kind of join us in the laying on of hands, if you just extend your hand out in front of you, if you're willing to, if you're... heart doesn't lead you that way, or the spirit doesn't lead you that way, don't feel obligated. Join me in prayer. Our Father and our God, we are thankful for the way that you send people into our paths, and we get to be blessed by them, and we get to be your blessing in their life. We thank you for the way you created us all with this motion of moving forward and on to the next thing. And as Jaden is graduated from high school, he's leaving us to go be part of the National Guard, to be part of the national defense of this country, for which we're very grateful. Father, we ask that you would go with him, that you would give him a keen sense that you're going with him everywhere he goes. We lift him up and we ask that you'd send an extra and a new measure of your spirit that will lead him in this new part of his life to discover what it means to be a soldier and to be a child of Christ. Not always an easy thing. We pray for whatever church homes that he will encounter while he's gone from us, that they will also reach out to him and make him welcome, and that he will become part of those places. But may he always know. And will you bring him back to us? And let us participate in the way that you have grown him a little further. And we can see your glory a little bit more clearly reflected in his life. Bless him as only you can. Pray this in the name of your son. And we all say together, amen and amen. Appreciate you, bud. Certainly do. Aren't we thankful for young people who want to serve God and serve in our military and be part of that protective arm? You know, it was at the very beginning. This is a story that starts all the way in some of the first words of Scripture. It is a plan, and at the center of God's plan was the idea of family. From the very beginning of the creation, particularly as soon as humankind's come into the picture, it is a picture of man and woman and life together, that they would be one and become one flesh, that they would leave where they're from and become one flesh. And just as much as that idea of marriage, man and woman in marriage, and that being the basis of family, immediately God affirms that this creation of male and female and what will come from that is fertility, fruitfulness, and that you will multiply, and we want you to bring children. And while we don't necessarily have evidence of children in the garden, the command to be fruitful comes in the garden before the fall. This is all part of God's perfect plan for the way it comes together. And so it's real intricate when we look at the Ephesians passage that Brian did such a good job of reading. I wanted to grab this whole context without even reading every word, but did you hear the gospel that Vic proclaimed to us this morning? Did you hear the transformation of life, that our lives should become more like Christ, and that integral to that gospel plan and that life transformation plan is the idea of family? It's called formally the family code. But notice that Paul felt it essential. And by the way, Ephesians is not the only place that he steps into that. There are echoes of it in other places, but it's almost identical in another one of his books called Colossians. So it was very important, if you were going to understand the gospel and understand our response to it, we had to re-envision what it was to be family. And so today, as we close out this series that started way back in the spring of focusing our vision, as we close it out, it seemed appropriate that we would talk about God's vision for families. We could preach in a number of different directions, and we could grab several different passages, but I want to emphasize three things that I've gleaned from scriptures, and not only these three that we'll be reading, but again, they're all informed by Genesis chapter 1 and 2 and Ephesians chapter 6 and that great expression, but maybe twist it in just a little different light in these three passages, and then three images that I'd like you to take home as you think about how your life in family needs to be transformed in attitude and action into more of what God would want it to be about. So the first place let's start is in Mark chapter 10, and read along with me. By the way, it's interesting, this story and slight variations of it are found in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They all felt like it was important to show Jesus in this scene and record it so that we would remember it. People were bringing little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this rebuke of the disciples and that the children were trying to come, he was indignant. He said to them, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." And verse 16 says, "And then he took the children in his arms and placed his hands on them and blessed them." The image I want you to get from this is the image of the nest. That family, God's vision of the family starts with the idea of being a nest. And this, by the way, is a symbol that comes from and is expressed in the Psalms multiple times and the prophets multiple times. That God wants to be this shepherd, this leader, this father. And in reality, the image is much more of a feminine, the mother kind of figure that takes the birds, the chicks, into under its wing in the nest as it protects them in that place. We all start off in this place. I've been blessed by, in the last 12 months, with two grandchildren, and blessed with getting to spend a little bit of time with each of them as they are in that stage in life where nothing except sleeping and eating and pooping and peeing are what they do. And if it weren't for somebody there to make sure that they got the rest and were laid down the way they needed to be, somebody was there to feed them, and somebody was there to change that diaper, it would be a mess, wouldn't it? And yet, in reality, see, this is the image that God wants us to understand that He feels towards us. And so we gain this idea of the protective nest, not simply as a human instinctual function, but as a reflection of who God wants us to be. But it's not just about babies, is it? Did you hear the description of husband and wife? If you read chapter 2, there's very powerful language, chapter 2 of Genesis, very powerful language about the way that husband and wife are from each other, of the same substance. And there's a very powerful sense that Adam feels this need to be protective and helpful to Eve, and Eve feels this need to provide for and care for Adam. That continues, and then you read it in Ephesians, and it takes on the language of Christ and the church, but don't you hear in that language this sense of husband and wife and the relationship as we move from two to the phrasing from Genesis that Jesus repeats, that the two will become one. And that is not just about procreation, but that's about the way that we provide and protect and care for each other. We continue to provide and protect for those children long after they're out of diapers. Amen? Somebody has to teach them that the fire is hot. Somebody has to teach them that the car that's coming down the road will kill you if you step out in front of it. Somebody has to teach them, by the way, that protective and providing sense. Did you hear the song that we sang just before the sermon? That idea that the breath in our lung needs to be directed towards praise. It doesn't come out that way naturally. Now, by the way, when I hear a baby cry, when I hear children laugh, I'm thinking, this is a hallelujah all to itself. But see, as we age, lose that sense of, well, we don't coo and gurgle anymore, do we? Most of the time, most of us. Our words become formed by our minds, but our minds get formed so that what comes forth from our lung is a praise and a hallelujah to God. That's about this protective and providing sense that we have for children. We, with Elise and Drew both, had a very specific ways in which when we dropped them off at college, we said, God has held us accountable for your provision and your protection. And while we will always be for you, here for you, this we see to be a significant passage where it is about you and God. And what will you do in your life to continue in His blessing and continue in His protection and in His provision? If you'd like to hear more about that sometime, maybe as your children are headed off, we'd be loved to have that conversation with you. But isn't it interesting the way that protection and provision actually reverses eventually in family, doesn't it? I'm ecstatic. My sister just retired. She's been a teacher and is retired and is moving to be near my parents. And I cannot tell you how much of a burden off of my shoulders that brings. Because there comes a time in life when the provision and protection, the nest that parents provide for children are called upon in God's vision to be intimately involved in our parents' lives in their care. That takes on many different forms in many different ways. And by the way, in my family, it's a very normal thing as you age to head into a nursing home. But it's not sent to a nursing home, never be seen from again, but simply the recognition that the care that is needed there is able to be provided by those people better than I can provide at home. And so in my family, there's not a fear of that. But make no mistakes, it's not a relegating. It is a gift that is empowered by the presence of family. When I was a very young child, I made regular visits to see my great-grandmother and her sister in the nursing home. Whenever we traveled anywhere, whoever in the family was not at home, we would go to see them wherever they were, because it was important that we be the nest for them as they had been a nest for others. Well, it doesn't stop with nesting, does it? It can't stop with nesting, because God always is having us grow. And as we grow, other things have to take place. I'd like to read with you this time from Deuteronomy chapter 8, if you'd join me there. Be careful to follow every command I'm giving you today. This is in this transitional moment as the children of Israel get ready to move from the wilderness where they've been for 40 years and into the promised land, on to what God wants them to do. Be careful to follow every command I'm giving you today so that you may live and increase and may enter and possess the land the Lord promised you on oath to your ancestors. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the wilderness these 40 years. And now here's the purpose. Here's the purpose. God used those 40 years of kind of, they weren't just standing still. He had a purpose behind them. To humble and test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep His commands. Let's keep going. He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors are known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Skipping down to verse 5, know then in your hearts. Isn't this amazing? That as a man, a father disciplines his son, so the Lord your God, the Lord your God disciplines you. Now, this is not a refutation of the idea that God's basic element, basic essence, is love. And that His basic and most prominent activity among man is to be about blessing them. But there is no division between God's love and His desire to bless and His need to discipline. And the image that I want you to get here for families is the image of the crucible. This is an old thing, and this is not something that we all get to kind of get a hold of. But in reality, anytime you deal with metals, particularly precious metals, you need to know what that crucible is. Because ore goes into the crucible, and dross comes off the top slowly but surely. The Bible will talk about silver being refined 7 times. That refining, every time that refining occurs, it's in a crucible. Something that provides a form so that it can be heated and tested and made more true to its essence, more pure. The Deuteronomy chapter 8 passage is very clear. God used the time in the wilderness to humble, to teach, to train, to refocus attention, to show how in such powerful, miraculous ways that God would provide our greatest needs. And we have to be people who are dependent on God in that way. We see this very clearly, of course, in the way that parents discipline and raise. And in reality, it isn't just the idea of discipline in the sense of correcting things, but stepping in to be trailblazers and saying, these are the paths that you need to travel in. And this is where, so powerfully, the idea of a church family, so that parents don't simply say, this is the way we do it as a nuclear family, but they can point to all these other people, your Bible class teacher, the elders, the women who help out in so many different ways, to see the way they live. Those are good paths for you. Those become additional navigating sort of stars for you to follow in. We want to shape and form that. But have you been a parent long enough to discover that the shaping of faith that goes on as you parent isn't simply about what you're teaching your children? I think in a very powerful way, the way God designed families and His vision for how they are supposed to work is as we raise our children, we come to know God better. As we struggle with their willfulness, as we struggle with their disobedience, we understand and our hearts are shaped more and more into an understanding of who God is in relationship to a willful and disobedient people. And maybe above all else, what we discover is parents, is where we're incomplete in that relationship to God. Because where we are incomplete is where our children will most often sort of touch our hearts and push us. That's not because they're evil. I really think that's the God thing in them as they reach for us. You know, even marriage itself, isn't it amazing how we have designed an image of marriage in our culture that says, oh, it's just about what you're going to get out of it. It's just about the pleasure that comes from it. If it's good for you, great. If it's not, then just get rid of it. That's not God's image of marriage by any stretch of the imagination. It's a great book written by a guy named, let me get his name up here real quick if I can. We can go to that slide. Gary Thomas. It's called Sacred Marriage, and he sort of asked the question, and I think we can affirm this, that God's plan for family is about, it's about that nest, but also that crucible, and that marriage itself is the idea that God may have designed marriage to make us holy, more conformed to Him than to make us happy. And I hope you'll maybe take a look at that book and see what he has to say. Finally, Ruth is such a powerful book in the Bible. It's tiny, 4 chapters. Just kind of squeezed in through all the chaos of judges and then what will become the chaos of the kings eventually is this beautiful, beautiful picture. And it's broken. It's not perfect. There's widows and foreigners. There's poverty and all those kinds of things. But in the midst of that, we have language that is so powerfully about family. It's amazing to me how many marriages will read the passage from Ruth where Ruth says, I'm not going to leave you and I want to stay with you. And we read it as if it's a husband and wife, but in reality it's a daughter-in-law to a mother-in-law. But it is that kind of loyalty, that kind of integration that we're looking for, not just in marriages, but in families. But I want to point to the end of the book because it's this such a beautiful picture about marriage. It's such a beautiful picture about loyalty and faithfulness and care and those kinds of things. But this is the way it ends, almost as if this is where we're going with this whole beautiful God-ordained and blessed picture. Whereas opposed to people who are just acting on their own selfish interests, but instead people who are acting for the interests of God in their community and in their lives, is all pointing to something. This is the way it ends. Then Naomi, who's Ruth's mother-in-law, takes the child in her arms and cared for him. The women living there said, Naomi has a son. There's powerful images there. And they named him Obed. But then the story wants to tell us that that's who is Jesse's father, and that's who is David, King David's grandfather. Last thing I want to be sure and point out to you is that God sees families as being a wheel. They are carrying forward to something. My marriage is empowered and invigorated, not just with the sense of what God is doing between the two of us, but it has a spin-off of blessing in our children's lives, but even more in the life of the kingdom. We see that in so many of you as well. The way your marriages and your families are not simply the idea of what can we do for ourselves, but we're spinning things off of that move the church and the kingdom of God and the gospel forward. Amen. We're launching children into something. Always, aren't we? We are launching them either into a mindset of, I'm going to go make a great living, I'm going to go set myself up financially, I'm become very influential and become very powerful, or we're sending our children. And by the way, church, this is real important. This isn't just about nuclear families. This is about church families. What are we sending our children out to do? And above all else, what do we want our children to be about? It's about changing and bringing people to the kingdom of God so that that which is promised in heaven has a little more reality right here on earth. We're moving forward. We're either moving forward in a way that has captured God's vision of family, or moving forward in a way that's just about propagating the selfishness and power-hungry and consumeristic sort of ideas that our culture spins around. So what's it going to be? Will we see family the way God does, or will we see it the way, in reality, our culture does? And if we're going to do that, at the heart of that is that our vision be much more focused on what God wants to transform inside of me much more than how I'm supposed to be changing other people. Yes, the crucible is always going to be about removing the dross and getting it back to what it's supposed to be. But in reality, the only way the crucible works is when the first heart that is laid on the fire is our own. Is that what your marriage is typified by? Is the idea that in my marriage I'm here to kind of fix them and get them right so that my life is better? Or am I seeing it the way God does and understanding that it's about what He wants to change in me so that my marriage can be full of blessing? Are you parenting with the idea of I need to fix this kid because this is either too expensive or this is too troublesome? Or is it about the idea that God wants to change something in me, and that if I'll change, It's amazing how parenting changes. Well, Vic said it well. Brian affirmed it. You know, there's nothing that God wants more. Nothing that God wants more than to see you become part of His eternal family. Amen? And the only thing that stands between where you are and where He wants you to be is you. Jesus has done it. The cross is a reality. The resurrection is a reality. And He says, come and be a part of what I'm doing. Let me change you. Let me make you into what you've always wanted to be. And let me bring you home. The invitation is extended. We're going to stand and sing a song. It would be an opportunity for anyone to come and make a public statement of, I want my life to be more aligned with God. Maybe even the idea of, I want to choose to be part of God's family by putting Him on in baptism. I promise you there's a baptistry and it's got good water right behind that right there. And we can get that out of the way. And what do you think, John? Minute and a half? Okay, if that's what you need, then we're ready to go. But isn't it more than that? Isn't the invitation always more than what somebody else is going to do besides going forward? Isn't the invitation much more about, what do I see? Where is my heart headed? And how can I better be God's nest, His crucible, and His wheel so that His family can be made a reality? Won't you come as we stand and sing?
Oh God, You are my God,
and I will ever praise You. Oh God, You are my God, and I will ever praise You. I will seek You in the morning, and I will learn to walk in Your
morning. I want to welcome you again to our morning worship this morning. And for our visitors especially, I want to offer you a token of our appreciation. We have some bread that we'd like to give you if you can raise your hands as these young ladies go back and share it with you. You know, last week I was up here and I was jet lagged, and this week I've got a sore throat. So I'm going to try to keep it a little bit short. As much as I can here so I can make it through here. So I want to thank Allen for his service this morning and about families. And, you know, families are the building blocks of our society. If you have broken families and families don't reflect God, you know, that's going to be a problem with society. And so we need to work on our families and make sure that they reflect God and be part of God's family. There's a couple of, back in June, or the 24th here, there was someone that entered the world here, Braden Warren. Braden Christopher Warren, who's the son of Chris and Kathy. And so we need to celebrate that. He weighed 8 pounds, 12 ounces, so he was a big, big boy. Also want to remind you that tonight we have the Family Feast Fellowship here, and it will be about David and Saul, and we also will have some food tonight, so if you can bring sandwiches or a dessert or chips, that would be appreciated. There's a lot more announcements in the caring and sharing. I'm not going to read all of them. That would take too long, I think. But so if you want to look at that, you can. You can find out about a wedding that's coming next Saturday over here. But one thing that did not make the caring and sharing is that Candy Crest, and I think Candy's here today. Is she here somewhere? Way in back there. I see her. Okay. She's going to be going back in for surgery, another surgery to recheck her scalp in July later on. So we'll keep her, and we need to keep her in our prayers. I think that's all the announcements that I was going to cover. Not anything else, shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we are thankful for all the many blessings you've given us. We want to ask that your Spirit guides us in our lives, and that our families are filled with your love, with love and respect for each other, and that they reflect your vision for our families, and that we are part of your family. Father, we want to thank you for the words that Alan's presented us, and that we use those in our lives. Be with us in this coming week. Thank you for sending your son to die upon the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's be standing for this closing song, please.
I'll come and love. Oh.